another meeting in the same week, and what we wanted to talk about today is pretty much the incorporation of Enex. That's why it was so important that Max participates, because he has a lot of knowledge in incorporating, especially in the European Union, and I hope we get some ideas together today.
Yes, absolutely. Incorporation is important. And I think this is an interesting topic because I think the main reason why we're doing this here at Enex is because we want to change the way we can organize corporations, quote unquote. And we've been doing this so far, and I think it worked tremendously well with the open source style projects and the volunteerism in the organization. I think it's worked perfectly so far. But nevertheless, we need a legal entity, at least on paper. It's not necessary from a actually working point of view, but it definitely is necessary from a regulatory point of view. And it's going to be interesting how we manage this. The first big question is, of course, in what country to locate. We are an international group, so we have a lot of options here. And I think the most important step for this is for each jurisdiction, the willingness of working with new technologies and disruptive technologies like this is, with a rather laissez-faire structure. There are several options. The biggest candidates are, of course, in the crypto market Switzerland, which has been used previously by previous startups and companies quite frequently, but also Estonia, Gibraltar, Liechtenstein, what else? Singapore, Hong Kong. So those would be the jurisdictions that have a open mind regarding blockchain startups, quote-unquote blockchain. Basically we want to have what's the opposite of strict? Loose guides and loose guidelines from the regulators that are not that restrictive, because we actually want to be as efficient as possible and as customer oriented as possible. And regulations oftentimes are a huge hindrance in that one. What do you say, support?
Yeah, I agree. And that's why I want to take a proactive stance towards the regulators and bringing solutions to them rather than questions, because I think they have a lot of questions from all kinds of projects, and they are kind of like busy hunting down these obvious scams. So if we bring them solutions, I think we should be like, once they realize that we are kind of trying to be in the same boat and we are trying to make the world a better place, we're not trying to scam anybody, I think that will be the path to take here towards regulation.
Yep, and it would be the best to find out what the regulators generally look at when issuing shares of a company. Like, of course, it's probably going to fall into securities legislation, but generally, the expectations, and we would need to somehow self-regulate together in cooperation with the regulator.
Yes, agreed. Yes. So I think we are 100% a security token because, I mean, we want to represent equity in this token. Which is the definition of a security token. And I mean, this is nothing bad. I think this is actually quite good. Nevertheless, there will be regulations, therefore. And the question is, how far can we apply the old regulation to this new technology? And this is something that the market in general, I think, will dictate. But I also think that I'm a huge proponent of private contracts and voluntary contracts. So if we have some form of, or if we reach some form of agreement with the investors, that they either waive some rights, quote-unquote rights, that they have under the SEC regulation or equity regulations in general. I think we can work with that as well. Of course, this needs to be evaluated by a lawyer, but as far as I understand it, private contract laws can still trump the broad umbrella regulation of the SEC and other securities regulation or regulators.
So what do you mean with private contracts with the investors? What contracts should this be?
For example, if the SEC or other security regulators require that you have to have an annual in-person meeting once a year to check the annual report and everything, this will be rather complicated for us simply because we are such an international group. And then if we make a private contract with the, or that has to be agreed upon at the point of investment, that we do not have an annual meeting in person, but rather, let's say, weekly or monthly meetings that are scheduled, then this would be something that if all the investors agree, we could do this instead of the standardized requirements in the regulation.
Okay, but I think this could be difficult because we're trying to get around the regulations again with private contracts. I don't know if this is possible and how this is possible. Yeah, but definitely a thing to have a look at. Okay.
Well, from a developer's point of view, the role of keeping it simple is really important. So I don't know, maybe it's also true in business contracts. The simpler the contract structure is, maybe the easier it will be also for the regulator. That's right. Just makes sense.
It's a universal thing. We should always try to take the road of least resistance. Like, it's a good engineering and good practice, good contracting and good coding. I think it applies to everything. So if we can cut all unnecessary complexness, it will be better and it will be easier to understand and also to explain.
Yes, absolutely. I agree.
So let's talk about incorporation. Like, what are our options at the moment? Like, let's make a list of locations that we are willing to consider, and what are the pros and cons of those. And we should probably make a decision as soon as possible and start pushing the paperwork to meet the MVP deadline.
Okay, so I just wrote down what Max said. So Swiss, Estonia, Gibraltar, Singapore, Hong Kong, and Liechtenstein. Swiss cons are, I think we need someone who lives in Switzerland to incorporate in the Swiss.
Yes.
Something like this Max told us. Liechtenstein is a lot of paperwork and almost impossible to get a bank account there as a con.
I mean, those two cons, I think, can be applied to pretty much everything.
Yeah, I think getting a bank account could be a big challenge. And I was wondering if there's a way to incorporate without a bank account, because I think at least in Finland, it's not, you know, I don't think it's possible. But that doesn't mean it's not possible somewhere else. Because I do think that we could manage without.
So the thing is, we do not need necessarily have a bank account for the day-to-day business activity. We could, being an incumbent business, simply use cash all day without ever having a bank account. That would be possible. Because in the current financial system, cash is the only legal tender law that is actually real currency, quote unquote. So that would theoretically be possible. So I don't think that there's any issue when saying, okay, no, we're just going to use Bitcoin or what other cryptocurrency we wish to use in the day-to-day business activity. However, I'm not 100% certain because whenever you are opening a corporation, you need to put down the funding.
Yeah, that was a thing I also thought about, the different minimum fundings. In Germany, for example, depending on what corporation you are, for example, a limited corporation or an stock.
If you have this money, those funds, you need to have an official statement of the bank. I mean, just on a technical side, we could simply put the 25,000 or 50,000 euros worth in Bitcoin into a normal Bitcoin account, sign a statement with the private key to prove that we actually own those funds. So on a technical side, this would be totally doable. However, I do not know if it is accepted by the authorities in the specific jurisdiction. This is something we should look into.
Yeah, I think definitely technically that is very possible. We could use a multisig also for that if we have to collateralize or deposit that amount somehow. Yeah, my concern as well is that who is going to help us to actually set that up? Because it's going to seem like a lot of hassle for all those all banks and funding bodies that we might approach.
What do you mean with who's going to help us set it up?
Well, I mean, if we, let's say that we approach a bank that we don't really want to open a bank account, but we want to deposit like 50,000 in Bitcoin. I just don't know if that's going to be realistic. That's what we're talking about, right?
Depositing Bitcoin. Go ahead, Tom.
Depositing Bitcoin into a bank. Which bank?
Yes, I was just going to say the same. I don't think we need that. We just need to prove that we have ownership of the funds. And now the question is if this ownership needs to be in euros or if it can be in another currency. So, for example, if you are incorporating in, let's say, Germany or Switzerland, you can incorporate with other currencies other than the euro. So you can make a German corporation that has its base capital in US dollars, for example. So it's not an issue of the currency. However, I mean, it's still a regulated, quote unquote, regulated currency that is put into a bank account. So there's still a difference between euro and US dollars and Bitcoin.
So it's more like a question of, will it be recognized as a currency or an asset that might be worth less in a short period of time, which creates a risk, I guess. What is the point of proving that we have such funds if we can just spend them anyway, if we don't have to lock those up anyhow? Like, I don't understand.
Yeah, absolutely. We do not need to lock up those funds. We just need the starting capital. You only need to have the 25 or 50,000 minimum. You can always have more at the day of opening the account, simply to prove that this is a legit corporation that has funds that it is going to use in order to conduct the business. But you could theoretically, on day one, spend all these funds on whatever cost you have, ordering products or whatever, and then you could be illiquid and basically be bankrupt on day two. This is not the issue. So it's not that we need to lock up those funds. We just need to prove that we are liquid on day one.
Well, that's not an issue. We just show up with a bag full of cash, and then we can just invest those afterwards. Or use them for expenses or whatever.
But the question is where to collect this money. I think we cannot do the first mini ICO until we have incorporated, because then we are not a company and we could not be legitimized by the different security authorities.
Yeah, I think probably that the first amount has to come out from our own pocket.
Yeah,
definitely. If we're talking about 50K, I don't think that's an issue. What do you guys think?
Yes, and this is not going to be... Go ahead, Tom.
How many are we? How much is it per head?
I think we are maybe 10 people active in the project, which would spend or lend 5,000.
Yeah, I think it will be around 5,000. Of course, we have to go around and ask who wants to be a part of that. Like that will become kind of like a founding point.
Yeah.
Of Enex in official form. So again, I don't think, like, personally, that's not a problem for me at least.
Pro. And if we get a few extra founders, then it would be actually beneficial for them to get in early. But even if it's just us 10, then it's also possible. I don't see a problem with that.
Yeah, me neither. Yeah. I mean, as anybody who wants to contribute and who wants to be a founder, then I think they are free to join in and put their money down. And then we incorporate, we kick off the first ICO, and all the funds will be paid back at that point.
Yeah, so they will either be paid back or they will simply be the initial investment in the, let's say, a Series A or seed round of the organization.
Or they will be subsidized with tokens, for example.
Yeah, let's consider that some Bitcoin exchanges like Paymium in France and some others also, they have started with much less.
Yes, there are also ways to start with less money. There are corporate forums in pretty much every country where you can start with even as little as €1. In Germany, that would be the mini GmbH, or the entrepreneur organization, if you translate it, the Unternehmensgesellschaft. In Britain, it would be the limited, which you can start with, I think, £1. There is also something like this in Liechtenstein. However, those always come with some negative points as well. And we're going to hatch out the details, especially because we want to have we should look into the opportunity of actually having the list of owners or the list of the representative of the owners not registered at a local stock exchange, but actually on the blockchain. And this can not be done in every country. At least I do not know how to do that in Germany. I do know it is possible in Liechtenstein and Switzerland. In Liechtenstein, it's the form of the establishment. And in Switzerland, I think it's the foundation where you can have the list of owners hidden or registered somewhere else other than the official exchanges, stock exchanges.
Okay, so are we squaring in on the form of company and the country?
I would propose that we do a little bit of research, because I'm in the process of incorporating my own company in Hong Kong. And I'm also aware that you only need, I think, like €1,000 worth of starting capital for the bare minimum. And there's other options as well. And I would be willing to do a little bit more research on that on behalf of Enex as well. And I would propose that everybody could kind of like take maybe one place of incorporation and do some research, and then we could have another meeting and compare our notes and then make an informed decision. Because right now it's difficult for me to have an idea of what would be the best way to go about it. What do you guys think?
Yeah, that's a really good point. And I think Hong Kong is going to be really interesting as well. So that's good that you already are gathering some experience there. I could focus here on Liechtenstein, simply because we have now created the two companies already, which everything now is finished. And I have a local contact there that is actually, it's his full-time job to incorporate partner organizations in Liechtenstein, so he might know a thing or two and know some possibilities of doing that. So I'll contact him and see what we can do.
That sounds great, and that makes perfect sense since you already have so much experience there.
I think I'll do the Switzerland part. Try to find out how to incorporate in Switzerland. I have some contacts. I'm working for Swiss banks. Maybe they know something.
Great. Fantastic. So that's already three big locations. Does somebody want to take Estonia?
Yeah, I can take Estonia because I can always talk to Asse Sauga from LHV Bank and Kaspar Korjus, and I have some friends there from the original kind of early scene. And then I can take a look at some other European countries like France, for example, because they have introduced some self-regulation aspect. So I could just ask directly from the regulator what's their position.
Great. Fantastic. Well, I guess that's the next step then. I set aside for myself this week to find out how to incorporate my own company in Hong Kong. So I'm thinking I will probably be able to do that legwork this week as well at the same time. So maybe do you guys think we could have come back to this topic in a week, like next week, Monday?
Could we say next?
Or do we need more time?
I got some exams on Saturday, so I'll have to learn a lot this week.
Sure.
Can we make any promises on how fast the regulators are going to give us an answer?
No, of course we don't know that, but we can still have a meeting, and if it looks like we need more time, then we just take more time. And personally, I want to do this thoroughly and as properly as possible with no rush. We'll just push the deadline back if need be.
Yep.
Yes, absolutely. And I mean, we're going to have a meeting next week or even probably later this week anyhow.
Right. We don't need to decide the topic now. So we already have, like, everybody has a lot of work to do. And yeah, I'm pretty happy with that. We can move on with that and then keep talking in Telegram, and we can like give a little bit of snippets of updates, how things go.
Yes, absolutely.
Perfect.
Do we have something else to discuss for tonight?
Nothing in my mind.
Yeah, I think that was the missing part from yesterday, and I'll try to edit the video as soon as I can.
Yeah, perfect. Thanks. Maybe one more thing regarding the banking. Just to, you know, stay here on record as well. It would be, I think, the best route to go without any kind of banking connection whatsoever. I think it's doable. Simply because we're raising the money in cryptocurrency, and all we have to do then is pay expenses, which is number one going to be salaries. And I think we all are happy to accept any kind of cryptocurrency, much more than any fiat currency. At least I'm more than willing. So
what?
And And then we also, secondly, we have to, of course, buy the equipment in with cryptocurrency. I've talked to one supplier of photovoltaic panels already, but only to a employee, so this is not a official statement yet. But he said that they are looking into how or if they should accept cryptocurrencies as payment. So I think the interest is there, the opportunity is there, and it is a buyer's market. So there are several suppliers out there, and we could just start ringing doorbells and asking them. And sooner or later, we're going to find somebody who is willing to sell their panels for cryptocurrencies. So I think that is going to be the best way to go. And then we would have the spending side done all in cryptocurrency. The other side, the income side, would then be we would have to require from the clients or customers that we built the solar panels for. We would have to require them to actually send us the cryptocurrencies instead of euros, which I think is doable as well. Simply because, again, we do have a lot of different projects that we could take care of, and we could simply pick one that is willing to pay for the electricity in cryptocurrency. Now, just as a reminder, the payments would not be denominated in cryptocurrency. So we would not say we're going to get every month 0.1 Bitcoin for the electricity produced, simply because the price of Bitcoin is way too fluctuate. What we would say instead is that the monthly bill is, let's say, 1,000 euros, and it's going to be paid in Bitcoin at the according market price. So we would still have the exchange risk between euros and Bitcoin, but nevertheless, because all our expenses and all the expenses and the income will be denominated in euro, I don't see that there's an issue. We simply use the currency Bitcoin both as the means of payment and the unit of account. Oh, sorry, not the unit of account, but the store of value.
Yeah, I agree with all of that, and even if we would have to, and we probably will have to at some point, pay somebody in fiat, we can just do so via invoice paying service. So that's not really a big issue, in my opinion. And I think also that if we approach these small companies that are looking to expand, or maybe they are interested already in cryptocurrencies, we can provide them with help. For example, how to start accepting payments, not just from us, but for the business in general, which is another valuable service we can provide them to maybe get a discount on the stuff. So that's also something to think about.
Yeah, really good point. Really good point. And I mean, we all know how Bitcoin works and how to set it up. So I'm sure we can manage how to help them setting it up and accepting it. And it's good for the ecosystem. The more people accept it, the better. So when we can do our part on supporting the ecosystem, then I'm gladly willing to do that.
Totally. Sounds great.